We thank you so much for joining us today. And joining us on the program now, Sheriff Mike Ezell. He's a candidate for Mississippi's 4th Congressional District. He just advanced to the runoff coming up on June the 28th. He'll be facing Congressman Steven Palazzo in that runoff election. Good morning, Sheriff. Thanks for joining Middays.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me on.
Yes, sir. So you're obviously a person who serves in law enforcement, and we appreciate your service there, sir. What compelled you to throw your hat in the ring and enter the political fray?
Well, you know, I'll tell you, like everybody else in Mississippi and around the country, I'm very concerned about what I'm seeing, especially since Biden took over last year, and I'm just totally concerned for our country and for our people. You know, I think about my kids, my grandkids, and you know, I just know that we can do better. And you know, we've got such a great state, a wonderful country, and I believe in America. And I love being involved in the community, and I've always been one to get out there and get started. Let's get something going on. Let's try to do what we can to fix problems.
In your meeting with people in the 4th Congressional District, which of course includes the coast and South Mississippi, Sheriff, what are you hearing? Is there principal concerns?
Well, gas prices, food prices, inflation. I mean, you know, you just think about filling up your gas tank in your truck, and I've been going around the district since I've been running, and, you know, in my 2006 Silverado, $75 to fill that tank up. I have been all over this district, and people are saying, look, something's got to give here. Number one, we can't keep our, you know, we're buying $10 and $20 worth of gas. You know, a can of coffee, you know, $13. You know, grocery, a gallon of milk. It is unbelievable, the prices that are going on, and this is unnecessary. We got to stop this mess.
What do you think the federal government should do if you were seated as a member of the House of Representatives? Is there any particular legislation that you would support and you would promote as a way to address those concerns?
Well, I would get in there first of all and start fighting to quit printing all this money. You know, we can't keep digging our way out of this massive hole that the government is doing right now by just continually printing money. People have got to be able to pay their bills and make their way along. But, you know, I will find some like-minded men and women in Congress that will stand up to this crazy spending that they're doing. You know, we can't keep printing money. We can't keep digging this hole that we're into. And, you know, I will be standing up, showing up, and screaming at these folks. I mean, the folks that are suffering the most are the people that are not making the money that so many, you know, higher-paid people are in this state. These folks are suffering. You know, our lower-income families are suffering. And, you know, we've got to get in there and fight for some relief for these folks.
Yeah, it turns out, I saw a report yesterday that the Senate, the committees that are working on the omnibus budget, which we got to do that again, as we seem to have to constantly do. We can't just get through a normal budget. But anyhow, that includes, of course, as you know, the most of that funds the Department of Defense, and they're calling for an increase of about $45 million. This is Democrats as well as Republicans, $45 billion, excuse me, to add to defense spending. How do you feel about that? Should we kind of just put the lid on additional defense spending, or do we just keep increasing that as well?
We can't cut our defense spending. You know, our enemies around the world know, you know, America, and we know that we're still the most powerful country in the world. We can't cut our defense spending. We cannot continue to fund so many things that we can't afford. You know, our number one priority is to protect this nation. And I say we protect this nation first, and then we, you know, it's like everything else you have in your own budget. You know, when I get paid every 2 weeks, you know, we pay our bills. If we don't have any money left over, we stay at the house. You know, and so, you know, I want better for them just like everybody else. But I want our nation protected, and I want us to quit wasting so much money that's being wasted every day in Washington, D.C. That's how we can do it.
The president and the Democrats have been talking quite a bit about forgiveness of student loans. The far left of the party wants $50,000. The president's tossing around $10,000. Your thoughts on that?
No, we can't do that. I mean, think about all the folks that have went through the years. Earned their degrees, spent money going to college. My own family, our daughter, she's a school teacher. We paid for most of her college. She got some assistance, for her good grades. But you know what? It's not fair to put a blanket on. We can't do this. I mean, that doesn't even make sense at all. I mean, there are some instances where some folks might need some relief. But in general, everybody needs to pay their own way. I've had a regular paying job since I was 14 years old, and I bought my own stuff when I was coming up. And I think it's only fair that everybody go to work and pay their own bills.
Do you think members of Congress should be able to trade stocks?
No. I'll tell you this, if they get some sort of special deal, of course, there's nothing wrong with being able to invest and save. Let me clear that up. There's nothing wrong with being able to invest and save. But it's not fair that if they have some inside information that could help them down the road, it's not fair for the common man, the common investor. But there's nothing wrong with trading stocks. There's nothing wrong with saving money. As long as you are on that same sheet of music as the everyday common man that goes to work at the shipyard.
How do you differentiate yourself, sir, from Congressman Palazzo?
Well, I've had 42 years of public service. I've been elected sheriff in a special election in 2014. There were six candidates running. I ended up winning with 62% of the vote. 2015, I was reelected. In 2019, I did not have an opponent. And that was the first time in Jackson County history a sheriff didn't have an opponent. And it all goes back to public service. I've always been one to show up when there's a problem. I've always been one to stand up against things that are not right, and I'll do the same thing. I've never been under investigation by any sort of outside agency. I've never been looked at like that. I've never had to worry about anything like that in my life. And I said when I got elected sheriff, because the former sheriff had been removed from office, I said, we're going to do the right thing every day, one day at a time. And that's the difference between he and I.
What are your thoughts about term limits for members of Congress?
I think that there needs to be some probably self-imposed term limits. I don't know if we'll ever see that happen. I'll tell you right now, I'll self-impose term limits on myself. I won't stay up there longer than 10 or 12 years. I believe in getting in there, working hard, like I've done at the sheriff's office, and we've been able to accomplish a lot of good things here for the citizens of Jackson County over the last 7 years, saving money, returning money, taking care of the community. And, I had no intentions of staying on as sheriff after the end of this term, which will end next year, and I'll do the same thing if I go to Congress.
To those who say that it is beneficial to re-elect and send incumbents with seniority back to Congress because they get committee chair assignments and the like and just have more clout. How do you respond to that?
Well, I'll tell you this. When I came into the sheriff's office, I was a young sheriff. I had to meet and get to know a lot of people. I've used my experience. I also say that these folks that get up there and are in these seats and they get this seniority. What I've heard around this district is that we haven't seen our congressman. He's only here at election time. And so what I will tell you is I will find like-minded men and women in the Congress. And I guarantee you if I go to Congress, I will get something done, senior or not, freshman or not. I will get in there and work hard every day just like I've done every day of my life. Sometimes I think seniority is good. There's nothing wrong with seniority, but what I will tell you is sometimes when you get complacent, if we get too much, sure of ourselves or things are handed to us easily, I think we need to get in there and work hard every day.
If you arrive in Congress and you're fortunate to be seated, I think you're well aware that entrenched leadership often can place a lot of pressure, especially on new members, freshman members of Congress. How do you resist that if it goes against your principle? We got about 30 seconds, Sheriff. Sorry.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'll tell you this. As a sheriff and a law enforcement officer and a law enforcement leader, there's no more pressure that can be put on a man or woman in that position. And I'll take that same courage and knowledge to Washington. I'm not afraid to stand up.
Sheriff, thanks for joining us here this morning on Middays. Good luck to you in the campaign, sir.
Thank you so much.